as a 背书 to interested buyer in transit. When we have a bills lading, we always talk about two parties, the seller and the buyer. The seller is usually the shipper, and the buyer is usually the consignee. And who issues the bills of lading? The bills of lading is issued by the carrier. The carrier, right? Carrier, 运输. The carrier is usually the 承运人, that is mainly the owner of the ships, 船东. But not necessary. It can also be charterer, 租船人. Okay? So these are the main functions of the bills of lading. And tonight we will treat it as a good exercise because I have Miss Chiang, who is going to help me to read all slides that are in Chinese. And this is going to be a recording and I could post it on YouTube. When you are overseas, you can refer to tonight's lecture. It'll be posted on YouTube, okay? Now, types of bearing. 提汤的种类, how many types of bearings are there? One, you have the liner service. Liner service is main shipping line, okay? Where the consignee is usually the buyer, right? And plus you have the word to bearer or holder, just like a check. A check you have to bearer and holder. Of course, you can strike off to bearer and holder. Then the party will only be the consignee, just like 支票. Now, bills of lading. Now, bills of lading containing the word to order or assign. To order or assign. So a bills of lading, you must imagine, is exactly the same as 一张支票. Now, the barrel bills of lading is delivery to the possessor. The possessor means the person who holds the bills of lading, just like 一张支票. Now, street bill of lading, meaning that delivery is only to the name consignee, just like a check. A check can be, you can strike it off, account payee, and only to the payee. Then nobody can entitle to the money in the check other than the name payee. Now, just to let you know why I introduced this bills of lading. You know that in Lebanon, in Beirut, recently there was a big explosion, right? And that was due to carriage of dangerous goods. Carriage of dangerous goods, okay? Now, the next slide, I will ask Miss Chiang to read in Chinese.
...提单的种类,班轮运输,收货人在其后加上 或交持有人,提单载明,凭指示或指定,凭提单持有人以及交付给占有提单的人,记名提单只能交付给特定收货人。But
there are other kinds of 提单, they are not considered as ocean bills of lading. They are not negotiable like in shipment, so you want you to remember. Okay, 有一些是货态提单，还有其他的. One, when they are issued, they are also called bills of lading. Do not forget, from freight forwarder, freight forwarder 是货代理, and they belong to logistic company. Logistic companies are 物流公司. They do give bills of lading, but remember, they are not documents of title. Remember, they are not documents of title. Okay? But there are sometimes goods carried on land and by rail, right? Then you have 提汤, that's that 包括陆路和铁路的运输的话物, 他们也是叫提汤, but these are not negotiable ocean bills of lading, not covered by shipping law. Now I'm talking about shipping law and ocean bills of lading. So these two, they may call themselves bills of lading, but they are not documents of title. Remember this. Now, the first function of a bills of lading, right, is a receipt. Now, tonight I'm going to speak to you mainly in English because this is my fourth lecture for this month or last lecture for this month. And I know all of you are very good in this second language called English. English is my first language. See? First function is receipt for the good ships, right? Meaning that the ditang serve as a sochi. It is an evidence that the goods were or the good are received in good order and condition. Number two, representations of facts at the port of loading and discharge. Loading is the port of loading, say from Ningpo to Singapore. Then the port of loading will be Ningpo and the port of discharge will be Singapore. And also contains the date of shipment. The date of shipment. When are the goods loaded on the ships? And also description of the goods. Do not forget, ditang is very useful for bank financing and in especially associated with letters of credit, documentary letters of credits in banking, xin yong zhen in banking terms, right? So the first function is ditang is considered as a receipt, so qi.
Always
remember, 信用证 is documentary letters of credit. When you do matters involving business, international business transactions, or something to do with Guamao, the two very important documents are, one, 信用证. They are interdependent, interrelated, very important documents for international trade for Guamao. Now we come to the most important thing. It's called clean bills of lading, right? The word clean doesn't have to mean that the documents are clean. It's just a legal term, okay? 清洁的地当 means that there are no annotation, meaning that there's no description, no clausing, 没有条件 that the goods are not loaded in apparent good order, okay? Usually, when you have thing with the words called weight or quantity unknown, right? 就是交货确实缺少, then the carrier, the 承运人 will not be responsible. If you have this word, weight or quantity is unknown, then the 承运人 不会负责任, right? The next one would be endorsement to third party. Now, endorsement to third parties, when endorsement is just a check, 背书, then 给谁呢? 地方者. Once it is endorsed, then the endorsee can always reject the goods upon arrival if arrive that are damaged or in bad condition. Remember this word, bills of lading, endorsed to third parties, and the carrier shall be estopped. Remember this word, estopped means prohibited, prevented from denying that the goods are not received in apparent good order. Once the bills of lading is endorsed to a third party, the carrier is estopped, is prohibited from saying the goods in the first place are not received in apparent good order and condition. The word is apparent good order and condition. Remember this word, estopped. When the bills of lading is endorsed to a third party, and good order and condition. Now, this I have a lady here from Papa, and she her name is Fang, Miss Fang, and she is going to give us a review of this case plus the Canadian case. Are you ready now, Miss Fang?
Yes, Professor.
Carry on, okay?
Good evening, everyone. 大家好，我是中国政法大学方淑欣。 然后给大家介绍今天介绍两个案子，第一个是 2002年的 The David Agmashinbeli 案件，本案讨论的是承运人根据船中的合理判断签发货物表面装上良好的提单的义务。案情是这样子的，承运人受委托运送了5000公吨的散装尿素，装货港是芬兰的卡特尔，然后船的大副在一张收据中写道。 船运送的货物存在变色，存在异物，在货物中发现了塑料、铁锈、碎石和黑色颗粒等。然后船长签发了提单，并在上面注明了与大副收据相同的内容。然后船长进一步拒绝在没有此措施的情况下签署提货单。由于船长拒绝签署干净的，就是清洁提单，那么因此无法使用更干的信用证明，从而造成了僵局。然后托运人因此起诉了船东。 依据证据，法院判定被污染的货物仅占全部装运货物的 0.01%。 这个案子的争议焦点在于承运人是否违反了 Hague-Visby Rules 第3条规定的签发记载有货物表面状况良好的提单的合同义务。托运人认为船长有义务签发一份准确记录货物的实际状外观和状态的提单，仅陈述他诚实相信内容是不够的。 此外，索赔人争辩说，船东应当要求向托运人开取提单的义务是无条件的、绝对的合同承诺，不应当以合理性 reasonableness 或者诚实信念 honest belief 作为条件。船东反驳说 Hague-Visby Rules 并没有要求提单的条款客观上准确，而重要的是是否符合一个娴熟的船长诚实的相信的货物的外观和状态。 最终的判决如下，法院判决船东胜诉，船东确实违反了 Hague-Visby Rules 第3条规定的义务，但由于并未造成托运人的损失，然后并不需要承担责任。法院认为 Hague-Visby Rules 第3.3条意味着提单条款应当包含对货物表面状况的描述，但这并不使得该描述本身成为合同条款，它也并不强加给船长一个绝对的义务来提供准确的描述。 那么，但船长的唯一的义务就是合理的评估，合理的评估，货物的外观状态。法院并不施加任何更高的标准，因为这将导致船长对货物的状况进行不必要的详细检查、详细调查。法院并不要求船长行使与专家、运船师同等的技能，也不要求船长除了认真审视外，还有具有更多的知识或经验。那么，根据证据，法院认为船长对货物变色的描述具有误导性。他认为合理的船长本来会增加一些说明，避免造成大部分货物已经变色的印象。因此，即使船东的论点被接受，他们仍然违反了 Hague-Visby Rules。 尽管船东违约，但索赔仍不被支持，这是因为即使船长正确的签了提单之后，已反映只有一小部分货物变色，索赔人仍然无法出示清洁提单，以换取最终买方的付款。但本案确立了船长在合理评估后开具货物表面状况良好的提单的义务。第二个 case 是 Re Canada and Dominion Sugar Cooperation Limited。这个案子是这样子的，就是承运人在运送一批糖时签发了发货物表面状况良好的提单，并附有注释，在保证船上在保证船上收货但是清洁的前提下签发此提单。然而，该批糖因为在码头存放过久，而且装货前已经受损。那么，那个收货船上收货单的记录中则记载着有许多糖袋受污，被撕开并被重新缝合。然后，票据的被诉人因此认为船东反言了，并应当因此承担责任。所以，本案的争议焦点在于船东是否构成了反言。法院最终判决，认为船东并不构成反言，因为发货物表面状况良好的提单附带的条件，就 Lord White 最终的判决提到，提单中确实清楚地记载了细条的说明，也就是 signed under guarantee to produce ships a clean receipt， 也就是在保证船上收货单是清洁的前提下签发此提单。这是一个清晰的、明显的被盖上的一个条款，它能够合理的向生意人传达：如果船上收货单是不清洁的，那么此清洁提单也无效。因此，船东并不构成反言。谢谢大家。
Very good， 两个案例的分析的很好。第一个呢，这个案例是 English case Admiralty。Admiralty is a high court。海事中院 okay? And the second case is a Canadian case, but it is 上诉到英伦的枢密院 AC means the House of Lords, or from outside England, it's called the Privy Council or the 枢密院 And 枢密院 is very interesting. It's 11 Downing Street. Number 10 Downing Street 是总理的住宅Then 11 is 枢密院 Now, descriptions of goods, another function, right? Describes the goods 的重量还有数量 Now, carrier will not be responsible for goods not loaded by the shipper. Not responsible if it's not loaded by the shipper. Common law, master has no authority, actual or ostensible authority to sign bills of lading when the goods are not even loaded, right? So this is basic common law principle. Descriptions of goods. Second functions of bills of lading.
货物的重量或数量，承运人不对托运人未装载的货物负责。普通法中规定，当货物还没有装船时，船长没有实际或表面的权利签署一组提货单。
Now we talk about the Hague and the Hague VSB 法规 for carriage of goods by sea. You need to remember.The Hague VSB rules, okay? The Hague VSB rule states quantity stated on the titang is conclusive evidence, conclusive sinchi, that shipment, once the bill of lading is endorsed or in the possession of the consignee, one is endorsed to third party, beisu, or given to the consignee. Conclusive evidence.Then there is a common law position. Annotation means clauses, 条款. You write some words on the bills of lading, like weight, contents, value, that does not destroy the evidence of quantity. All right, you can put weight and contents and value unknown, but the quantity mentions on the bills of lading.Right? You have to bear responsibility. And this is again another Privy Council decision in 1962. Containerization. Right now, most of the goods are ships on containers, right? 纸装箱. Then it is impossible for the master 就是船长, to open the containers to know what is inside the containers, right? So things have changed dramatically. Say to contain, SDC will have the effect of destroying the evidence of the quantity given to the shipper, because this is different now because of containerization. Containerization has affected the shipping law, because right now, if most goods are ships on the Zhongxiang goods ships, right? 一艘船目前都是纸船商船. Now, description of conditions. This is the next functions of the bills of lading, which is descriptions of condition. All right? Number one, apparent good order and condition of the goods refer to external and apparent condition, means that from outside, 表面, what do you see? The good must be discernible upon inspection, means that with your inspection, you must be able to see the goods are damaged or color, right? And when you have containerized shipping, then it's quite difficult because it's packed and sailed by the shipper. Then owners will have to depend on their local dailiren. It is difficult to see what is inside the container. So shipping law and international trade have been right now affected because of containerization. It is difficult to 描述货物的情况. Difficult. Now, this case has already been discussed, right? Now, the situations of shipment of urea in Finland. But this case here, the bills of lading was dramatically discolored and also contained materials. But contamination, do not forget, was only 0.1%. Notwithstanding this, the carrier was still liable for failure to issue bills of lading recording good order and condition. Can you just imagine? Urea. This is used for fertilizer. Urea is used for chemical fertilizer. Right? And the contamination was so small, 0.01%. And yet the carrier is liable. Now, from next month onwards, all my lectures will be I'm going to use Tenxin, Weiyi, or Zoom. I'm not going to use Qiye Weixing, because Qiye Weixing is not very useful for online teaching. From next month onwards, I'll be conducting all lectures on Zoom or on Tenxin. Now, this case has already been discussed earlier, right, by Ms. Fang. So I'm not going to discuss it anymore, right? This is a case study, a Canadian case that I'm familiar with. Now, the last functions of a bills of lading is evidence of contract. Evidence of contract. 海上挂物应诉合同的证明, evidence of contract. It's not a contract. Do not forget. Right? 地当不是合同, it's evidence of contract. There are two different things. It's evidence of contract. Now, the bill of lading is not a contract, but evidence of contract. The ship owner, 船东, or 船东的代理人, will have to conclude contracts with the shipper, or his broker before the issuance of the bills of lading. The ship owner, the carrier, the 船东, has to conclude the contract. Then, the lading would serve as evidence of contract. Contract may be in the form of booking notes, shipping notes, and fixtures note. I've seen all these things in when I conduct court cases in England, you know, like booking notes, shipping notes, and fixture notes, right? Something that I've already seen in maritime arbitrations.
,而是通常被描述为合同的证明。
Forwards the PPT and place them, but only for this lecture on 企业卫星, because the topic is very important for unclean bills of lading and also for the course on international business transaction and also for Wangmang. Okay, I've already said it is a document of title, just like documents of title. It serves as a document of title. Like when you buy property, you be issued title deeds, right? Title deeds are legal documents of title of your property. But bills of lading is also a document of title. One, it is, as mentioned, if it is a negotiable bills of lading, the parties are described as the name consignee. Name consignee, usually the buyer, or to his order, or to his assigns. Assigns is Beisu, right? Now, what is the purpose of all this thing? It's to get banking facilities. It's to get banking facilities such as documentary letters of credit, 信用证. Very important for international trade financing. So that's why I say it's very important for 银行贷款, right? Because without 信用证, there will be no 网贸. And 信用证 and 提单 are very important documents, extremely important documents for your understanding of international business transaction. Now we talk about unclean bills of lading. What are the banking and legal consequences? Right? Yeah, someone translated as 法律的后果, meaning that unclean bills of lading does not contain any reservation as to apparent good order of the goods or the packing. You cannot describe that. The goods are color. That is, that would definitely make the bills of lading unclean. Now, if you qualify the apparent good order and conditions of the cargo as described in the bills of lading, if it describes that the conditions of the goods, and this is from Evans J. Evans J. 是法官，他是威尔士人。In fact, this judge was my pupil master when I was trained as a barrister in London. This judge was my pupil master, and I was his pupil in London. Evans J. Right? So these are the judicial definitions of unclean bills of lading. Firstly, you must have no description whatsoever about the apparent good order. Means that can be inspections with your observations by your inspector. You cannot describe the goods as color or the goods as slightly damaged in any form. And once it's endorsed, even if it is 0.01%, you are still liable, as mentioned in the Canadian case.
清洁提单的利害关系，受领人，货物和商品的CIF买家，国际销售交易中的银行和跟单信用证。
Yes, the interested party will be the CIF buyers of goods and commodities. CIF buyers means that the buyer will have to take care of insurance, shipments, and freight. FOB is when the seller will just deliver the goods and the buyer will have to take care of everything else. CIF buyers. So it's FOB and CIF. Remember these words. Right? And the interested party would definitely be the financier, the banks, because the banks have to issue 信用证 for international business transaction, right? International business transaction. Then you must always remember that when you have 信用证, you have to understand UCP 2007年, that has something to do with 信用证, right? This is 2007年的条例, right? Now, a bank, any bank will only accept a clean transport document. A clean transport document is one bearing no clause or annotation expressing, declaring a defective condition of the goods or their aging. You cannot say the facts that like the rice or sugar are broken. That is a description of the packing. Or you cannot describe the goods as stained. Remember, this is associated with 信用证, the 2007 UCP. Then you have confirming them. Yeah, okay, you can carry on reading. Yes, very good.
Okay. 国际贸易中拒绝接受不洁净提单的基本理由, 保对银行发现自己处于不利的境地, 被开证行拒绝付款, 这涉及到 CIF 卖方和买方.
So remember, when you have international trade, when you have 信用证, you will have the issuing bank and the confirming bank. Sometimes you have the issuing bank, confirming bank, and then one more bank as intermediaries. The confirming bank is the one that will confirm the of the documents. Remember, a confirming bank stands to find itself in unhealthy position of being refused payment by the issuing bank. The issuing bank means the bank representing both the CIF seller and the buyer. So this is matters relating to documentary letters of credit in international business transaction, right? So there are practical problems too. The seller will be to, the seller needs to have money, needs to have payment under the documentary credit issues in contracts for international sales of goods because the seller wants payment. Then between buyer and seller, right? Usually there are two banks, sometimes three banks. Now, the apparent good order and conditions that I have already described many, many times, right? This is a 表面, must have very clear words. Now, these words on bills of lading constitute an affirmation by the master 船长 of a statement made the shipper as to the condition of the goods at the time of delivery to the ships. Right? Such words are a statement, are a representation that have legal consequences for the person making the statement. Now the consignee, the buyer, rely on the truth of the statement, and the ship owner, the carrier, will be estopped. The word is estopped from denying that the goods are not ships in apparent good order and condition. Right? You must understand all this very clearly. Apparent good order and condition. Now, I'm going to ask my Julie Tao Wang from Beida, and he is going to give us a commentary on his understanding of apparent good order and condition. Hao Wang.
Thank you, Professor. 大家好，我是来自北大法学院的黄涛。那么接下来我给大家介绍一个关于清洁提单的案例。在有关清洁提单的纠纷中，的 Galatia 案是判断提单清洁与否的典型案例。在该案中，托运人为运输承包了一艘名为 Galatia 号的轮船，将1200吨的糖从印度运往伊朗，但在货物专运上船的过程中，船上发生了火灾，导致200吨的糖受损。在对货物进行抢救并最终完成装运后，承运人签发了一份带有批注格式的提单，提单承认货物在装船时表面状况良好，但由于遭遇了火灾，200吨的糖遭遇了共同海损。此后，买方和银行主张此提单为不清洁提单，并拒绝付款。托运人将其告上法院，法院在审理后认为该案的关键在于200吨遭遇共同海损的货物是否会影响承运人签发的清洁提单的效力。那么首先，清洁提单是指不存在承运人知道或怀疑提单记载的货物的包数、件数、重量或者体积与实际接收的货物不符，并在提单上批注说明不符之处的情况。那在本案中，承运人签发的提单是带有批注的，这也是买方和银行认为该提单为不清洁提单并拒绝付款的主要原因。而承运人对于判断一个提单清洁与否的标准，主要在于货物在装船时表面状况是否良好。这一标准要求承运人应当对货物表面状况进行检查，如有不良状况，应当如实批注。这里的表面状况是指目力或肉眼可观察到货物的表面状况，比如包装是否破损、 或有水湿痕迹，货物表面是否有刮痕等。因此，在本案中，承运人签发的提单中承认了货物在装船时表面状况良好，就应当认为该提单为清洁提单。而同样，在该提单在法律意义上成为清洁提单后，根据禁止反应原则，当事人即承运人和买方不得主张某种权利来否定自己做出的具有法律效力的行为。此外，在该提单成为法律意义上的清洁提单后，即使是船舶和货物在装船后遭受灭失，或者产生了分摊共同海损或救助的责任，也同样不能作为拒绝提货和付款的理由。买方和银行不能以此进行抗辩。因此，我认为有批注提单与不清洁提单不能相同并论，不清洁提单一定是有批注的提单。但是有批注的提单不一定构成不清洁提单。对提单批注的认定，即提单批注是否构成不清洁提单，关键是看批注的内容。只有反映货物包装或外表状况不良的批注，才能使提单成为不清洁提单。此外，法官在审理后也指出，该提单上批注的文字仅仅叙述了事实的经过，而不影响其在商业流转中被接受，因此仍然可以认为该提单为清洁提单。那么这就是我今天所介绍的案例，谢谢大家。
Excellent presentations, Tawang. Excellent. You have a very clear understanding of apparent good order and conditions in clean bills of lading or unclean bills of lading. You have complete understanding. Very good. Now, judicial review. These are some of the judicial review in a summary. One, goods were damaged after shipment and ships in apparent good order and condition. Annotation like that, cargo covered by this BL has been discharged, damaged by fire and water used to extinguish fire because the goods were damaged after they were shipped. So both buyer and his banker rejected the BL. Now, court of notwithstanding this, the Court of Appeal concluded it was a clean BL. So, Tawang, what you have described, can you have it posted on our TA Weixin, okay? Because I like the way you presented your commentary. Right? Now, which are acceptable annotation? Meanings that annotations that would not affect the cleanliness of the bills of lading, meaning that some annotations are acceptable and it will not make the bills of lading unclean. Like, for example, weight, measure, 数量, conditions, contents, and value unknown. This is acceptable. Will not make the bills of lading unclean. Number two, and it is very common, shipper's load and count. You can find it in the most all the titang, Toyingland. You can find it in all the titangs described by the Toyingland as shipper's load and count. And number three, said by the shippers to contain. 包括 the 包含 包括 the 数量 多少个 kilos, you know, that is acceptable. And other annotation based on judicial decision and UCP, mentioning the UCP do not make the bills of lading unclean. So these are acceptable annotations. Now, then there is a clause which has now been introduced, and they are called the RELA clause, right? RELA clause, I will ask Ms. Chiang to read the Chinese words so that they have a clear understanding what is RELA clause. Okay, Ms. Chiang?
提案中的锈蚀条款, 如果货物是铁、钢、金属或木材产品，表面状况良好阶段是指在金属产品没有可见锈蚀或水分的情况下，或者在木材产品没有破损、腐烂或变色的情况下。
Yes, this is a new introduction. When I have this clause on the bills of lading is still very clean, especially when you're dealing with metallic goods, right? Like 铁矿 or 木材. It is impossible, right? Not to have anything that you know is impossible when you ship any metallic goods from A to B, 没有生锈。不可能的事情，or 木材，that they have to be 100% clean and no decay or moisture，right? So you have this clause called the regular clause. With this, I will conclude lecture 4, which will be my last shipping law lecture for the month of September 2020. There will be resumptions after my return back to Canada, that will be lecture 5 in October. So I wish everyone good night and thank you for attending lecture 4. And I wish to thank the three Tuli from Fa Ba, Bei Ba, and Watson, Ms. Chiang, Ms. Wang, and Mr. Wang for assisting me tonight. Good night, everyone.
Good night, Professor.
Good night, Professor. Thank you
Thank you, Professor.